What's up, you guys? Marty Schwartz here with Marty Music. Now, music journalists can be very easy to hate. Just ask about any musician, and there are plenty of music fans out there happy to give their very concept of criticism a thumbs down too. But are critics really bitter haters, jealous of other people's talent? Or are they normal men and women just like you and me, trying to do the best job they can in an unstable industry? Are they walking cultural thesauruses who have a gift for synthesizing disparate elements into a cohesive narrative, thus enabling society to have a conversation with ourselves about the art we are creating? Or are they just huge weirdos with a chip on their shoulder? The answer, I think, is a little bit of all the above. Last century, in the 1900s, you could find almost all cultural criticism in two places: newspapers and magazines. But the rise of the internet didn't just pull the rug out from under the music business. You can connect the dots from Napster to MySpace to YouTube and SoundCloud. It's still taking down the publishing industry too. Dozens of magazines shut down every year. Spin, NME, and Blender are just a few music magazines forced to transition from print to all digital content. And when the private equity bosses yell at newspapers to cut costs, who do you think's the first to get a pink slip? Culture writers, that's it. I'm never happy when people are out of a job, but like all revolutions, there have been some positive changes in the industry too. Old school newsrooms were heavy into gatekeeping, and music journalists in the 20th century tended to skew really, really white and really, really male. That's great if you were looking for 100 Lester Bangs copycats. Not so great if you needed someone to be sincere about Toto. Sorry guys, hold the line, rules, I will not be taking questions. So not only has the internet opened the doors to diverse critical voices, thus expanding music criticism's area of expertise, it's changing people's ideas about what the format is capable of. Music criticism isn't just album and concert reviews anymore. A Vox video about the history of the 808 is music criticism. Deep dive podcasts about one particular artist, song, or genre are music criticism. My many excellent videos are music criticism. Yelling with your friends on Twitter about why Greta Van Fleet rules is music criticism. Kind of. By the way, bloggers aren't necessarily music journalists, but they can be important music critics. And when I say bloggers, I don't mean listicle assemblers and press release rewriters. These are content creators, and they make the workday a little more bearable, but music journalists, they ain't. Bloggers, for the most part, are extremely knowledgeable amateurs and true music fans who want to write for other music fans. There's no money in it, very little respect, and few perks other than online abuse. Again, there's so much beauty in the diversity here. You can find websites that cater to fans of basically every kind of music on the planet. Even real music journalists aren't a monolith. Critics fight amongst themselves constantly. The great rockism versus poptimism debate isn't just about why Carly Rae Jepsen kicks ass, it's about what people value in the music we listen to and why. Sometimes critics even start fights with entire genres of music, and guess what? It's almost always for the right reasons. For years, country music journalists have called attention to the fact that mainstream country radio pretty much does not play female artists, like at all. Just ask Kacey Musgraves. If art is about communicating ideas, what idea is being communicated to female country fans here? Voices that sound like yours basically don't exist. This isn't an easy or fun conversation for Nashville to have, but it's a necessary one, and it's only happening because a handful of music journalists are willing to piss people off. Speaking of Twitter, stan culture has really affected how critics approach their work. Stans, obsessive superfans named after the Eminem song, will not abide anything other than 100% positive coverage of their favorite band or artist. What's a critic supposed to do if a high-profile musician with a vicious fan base release a clearly mediocre song? Nobody's perfect, not even Taylor Swift. Gentle, constructive criticism can be met with a deluge of online abuse, doxing, death threats, and worse from potentially thousands of rabid fans. But as bad as some fans can be, that's nothing compared to the complaints from the artists themselves or the machines built around them. Publicists will call you to yell about unfair coverage and play the old access journalism game, because famous musicians have much more leverage than freelancers getting paid in McDonald's coupons. So, would you rather write an honest review of a crappy record no one will remember in 6 weeks, or score an interview about a big summer tour? Better choose the right answer or you're gonna lose your job. This isn't to say artists are too thin-skinned and need to learn how to take criticism. We're all human. A lot of you watching are musicians, so you know it takes bravery and self-confidence to put yourself out there as an artist. And almost all artists can take the heat anyway. The coolest of the cool do what they want to do, regardless of what the critics say. But all writers write with an audience in mind, and it's just bad journalism to write a review because you're afraid a celebrity might rip you a new one. Ideally, music journalists are writing for the music fans. And when you come across some nonsense criticism, ask yourself, are you the intended audience for a piece? Let's say you're really, really into drone metal. Would you rather read an article about Sun from USA Today or a blog about drone metal? Obviously the blog. What if your dad started to ask questions about the band? First of all, cool dad, and he's the perfect audience for the newspaper article. The bottom line is this. Sometimes you have to criticize the things you love. Everyone has different opinions and preferences, and every critic has different standards. Musicians and critics both are still trying to find their footing a generation after their respective industries caved in. And you know what they both have in common? Loving music. Would you give this video an 8.9 on Pitchfork? Are there any other topics you'd like for me to discuss? Let me know in the comment section. And don't forget to like and subscribe to Marty Music. Thanks again. We'll see you real soon.